It's a day of rest. On the eighth day of Christmas, oh, how I want to sing. On the ninth and the tenth day, how I want to sing. The Christ in the manger,
on that holy night,
in all of creation,
take a day of rest,
as we've been forgiven.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Hope. Don't worry, they're going to be back. That wasn't it. You know, there's more, plenty more where that came from. So you are really in for a treat today, and we are so glad that you are worshiping here with us this morning. My name is Amanda Neppel, and I'm one of the pastors here at Hope. And I want to ask you, if I were to ask you about the best gift you'd ever received, or maybe the most memorable gift you've ever received, we're in church, so the first answer is Jesus. So let's acknowledge that. And then let's talk about the next best gift after that, or maybe the most memorable gift after that. The one I'm going to tell you about is certainly not the best. You'll understand why in a moment, but it is very, very memorable. I was 8 years old, and what 8-year-old Amanda wanted more than anything in the entire world, are you ready for this, was a stuffed Simon of Alvin and the Chipmunks. It didn't talk, it didn't move, it did nothing besides sit there with its glasses on, kind of cockeyed, and that furry, like, yarn hair. That's literally all that it did. But I had my heart set on Simon. Not Alvin, you know, he was the leader. I was drawn to the nerdy one who was always trying to keep everybody in order. Go figure. And so, I wanted Simon so much. And we had opened gifts at all of our different stops, and we were at Grandma's house, and it was the last time we were going to open gifts. And we got to the end, and there was no Simon. And we were raised very specifically, like, you are grateful for what you have. You don't ask for more than what you've been given, because, you know, asking for too much is a recipe for disaster, for heartache all of the time. So you're grateful. A grateful heart is a happy one. So these are really good things. These are positive things to teach our children. But for 8-year-old Amanda, please don't judge me too harshly, okay? I knew that I was going to be taking a significant risk with my life by asking my parents about this, but I decided that in the name of Simon the Chipmunk, it was worth it. So I went to my mom and I asked, and here's the thing, here's what I found out. Simon had actually been purchased. Simon just hadn't made it under the tree. So I took my life in my own hands, and it paid off. He had just forgotten, and in all the chaos, it had just been forgotten. So in that moment, as silly as this is a silly example, but I knew that my parents saw me, that they loved me, that they didn't necessarily understand my bizarre affection for this stuffed rodent, but they knew they didn't need to. They were totally okay with it. And so I knew, I was blessed to know that my parents wanted to give me this good gift. They wanted to bless me because they loved me. Just a few minutes ago in our Bible reading, you heard Mary's song of praise, the Magnificat. And it's called that because that is the first word of that poem in the Latin. There's nothing magical or mysterious there. That's just the name of it then from the Latin. And Mary responds this way eventually after spending some time with her cousin Elizabeth, and she responds with this song of praise. The song of praise that we can be reminded of from Hannah, when Hannah found out that she would have a child in 1 Samuel, Mary responds with this heartfelt song of praise because after speaking with Elizabeth, Mary knows and understands that God has seen her, that she is this completely obscure young Jewish woman in the Roman Empire, and she has been seen, and she will be blessed. And she knows that people are going to remember her the same way that they've remembered Abraham and the prophets and the history of their people. But the thing is this, Mary didn't exactly start out with this song of praise. A little bit earlier in Luke chapter 1, Mary is visited by the angel and she's told that she's going to have this child. And at the end of all of that, the transition then into Mary going to see her cousin Elizabeth, Luke chapter 1, verse 38 says, after a few days, Mary hurried to the hill country of Judea. And I love that. After a few days. Here's the deal, ladies and gentlemen. Mary needed a hot minute after the angel had told her what was going on. I've got a bunch of kids, and so here's something that I know for sure. Under the best of circumstances, finding out that you're having one or another one, under the best of circumstances, takes a minute to get used to, right? I mean, that you gotta sit down and ponder on that for a while and just realize what's actually going on here. And Mary needed that time. Luke 1, verse 38, after a few days then, Mary went on to see her cousin Elizabeth. Mary needed some encouragement and some strengthening, and that's what she found there when she saw her cousin. Elizabeth was pregnant at that time. She's 5 or 6 months pregnant with the baby boy that would grow up to be John the Baptist. And Mary enters their home, and Elizabeth does this beautiful thing. Elizabeth looks at this younger woman who is a little freaked out, a little bit scared, has had some time to ponder the consequences of what's going on. And Elizabeth, filled with the Holy Spirit, then begins to prophesy over Mary. She speaks words to Mary that are strengthening to her, that are encouraging to her. She says, Mary, at the sound of your voice, my baby leapt with joy. Mary, why am I so honored that the mother of my Lord would visit me? And then she says the most incredible thing at all. She says, Mary, you are blessed because you believed that the Lord will do what he said he would do. You are blessed, Mary, because you believed that the Lord was going to make good on his promises. Those were healing words for Mary. Those removed fear and doubt and anxiety. And then is when Mary responded with this song of praise. Mary knew then that it was going to work out. She didn't know how, but she knew that it was going to work out through Elizabeth's prophecy over her. She knew that the Lord had seen her and blessed her and loved her. That's what we all long to experience, isn't it? To know that God sees us, that God wants to bless us with his love and his presence and his spirit. We even kind of long to know that God wants to give us those silly little things that we just want, that the heart just wants, right? And Christmas is the time when we begin to experience God's answer to our longing. We are all hardwired with that longing for God. There's nothing that we can do about it. And in Christmas, God shows up and shows us what the answer to that longing is. God, who did anything, who has done everything, who could have done literally any single thing God wanted to do, the God who created the heavens and the earth, the entire universe, showed up that night. I've read that if you take one single flat piece of paper, and you imagine that that's the distance from the earth to the sun, this one single flat piece of paper, then the distance from the earth to the nearest star is 70 feet of paper stacked up. And that's just within our own galaxy. If you look at across the Milky Way, if you were to stack up the paper, if one piece is the Earth to a sun, to the sun, it's 300 miles of stacked paper. That's how powerful, that's just the Milky Way that we know of. There are other galaxies we don't even know anything about. The God who can do that, the God who literally hung the stars in the sky, the God responsible for that knowingly and purposefully came to Earth as a baby that can't even hold up its own head. That's how much God longed to be with us. That's how much God longed to show us that he does see us, that he does know us, that God, in the form of Jesus Christ, this third person of the Trinity, came here to earth to be with us. And we know, because of where we live in time, we know that Easter is coming. We know that in a few months, we will be celebrating the resurrection of our Savior. For some of us, though, if we're honest, we struggle to understand what the resurrection means for us and why it matters. And with all due respect, I would just offer that possibly we struggle to understand the meaning of the cross because we struggle to believe that it was God that was hanging there. But the truth of the matter is, that night, God showed up to be with us because he loves us and wants to bless us. If it wasn't God who showed up in the manger that night, then it wasn't God on a cross. But praise God, spoiler alert, it was God in the manger and it was God on the cross. He is here. He is here with us now, and the time has come for us to celebrate the fact that God showed up, that God wants to bless us. The manger points us to the cross in just such a significant way because it reminds us that the God who showed up is the same God that died for our sins and saved us from ourselves. And in this season of Advent, as we prepare, after we leave here today, by the time we are blessed with this gift of music, the temptation is going to be to just kind of like, you know, get into a holy huddle and say, can we just stay here? Because it's going to be dark and the lighting's going to be beautiful and it's going to be amazing. And we know that when we leave here today, things are just going to go sideways because they just do. And we're just people, and that's how it goes, and it's this final push before Christmas. But I would encourage you this week, hope I pray for you, that you would remember that during this season of Advent, this fact that God has shown up reminds us and tells us that he wants to bless us with his love and with his presence. He wants us to experience him. He wants us to know that there's nothing that we have felt or experienced that he hasn't experienced. And so we can trust that he's good for it. We can trust that God is going to do what he said he's going to do. It doesn't have to look crystal clear, but he invites us to trust that the God who loves us will do what he said he will do. Amen. All right. Are we ready, everybody? They're ready. They're just waiting for me to be quiet. All right. Without any further ado, I give you the 2018 Cantata.
Thank you. welcome, everyone. It's that time of year when we gather to celebrate the season of Christmas. Do you remember your first Christmas? The waiting, the wondering, the wanting, and the wishes? Were you excited about what joy might be wrapped for you beneath the tree? Are the sights, the sounds, and the sense of mystery of that first Christmas lodged in your memories? Well, here comes that Christmas season again, filled with different sights and new sounds, ready to add to your memories. What if instead of focusing on the excitement the season brings, we choose to anticipate what Christmas brings? Step back in time with us. Stand on a hill just outside a tiny village called Bethlehem. Picture Mary and Joseph as they pause for a moment on the outskirts of town. What could this place possibly offer them? Joseph lived in an unhappy, suspicious, fearful, and needy world. A world of turmoil. A world of moral degradation. a world of low standards, a world tainted by hatred. Government oppression was intolerable. Personal needs could scarcely be met. Religion focused on judgment, not grace. People had lost purpose, hope, and faith. Was that then, or is it now? The world needed something then, and we need something now. Or is it someone? The story continues. Mary was told she would give birth to the Savior of the world. This Savior would bring down princes and exalt the humble, show mercy to those who feared him, fill the hungry with good things, and send the rich away with empty hands. Out of darkness comes light. Out of fear comes strength. Out of hatred comes love. Out of mystery comes hope and promise. The Messiah was prophesied to do all these things. Can you imagine the expectations surrounding this little baby?
Forever, Lord, children of faith.
Mary and Joseph were escaping from fear, from turmoil, from noise, from chaos. They were searching for peace, hoping for quiet, longing for God to show up. Sound familiar? Have you found the peace and quiet you need? With Christmas just a week away, are you stressed out about everything left to do? Are you feeling overwhelmed? Do you feel the season is out of control? Do you just want this whole Christmas thing to be over? If we're honest, this is what many of us are experiencing. As an antidote to the chaos, let's quiet ourselves and look to Mary and Joseph. Let's stop a moment and step into their world. He is here. He is here to heal the brokenness of many years ago, and he is here to heal our brokenness today. This gift of God, this baby, brings peace, brings comfort, brings strength. Too many of the gifts we receive at Christmas are ones we'll exchange, or will wear out, or will sit forgotten on a shelf. But what if we receive something that lasts forever? What if we receive the gift of love? Jesus is that gift. As we read in the Gospel of John, "For God so loved the world, so loved you, that he gave his one and only Son. This is the gift that lasts forever, the gift of the Father's love through his Son, Jesus Christ."
Both proud and proud.
The Savior of the world is here. What did that mean for Mary and Joseph? What does it mean for us? Just like any new parents, Mary and Joseph would watch this baby grow up, learn to walk and talk. They would see him struggle and celebrate when he overcame adversity. They wondered how he'd be treated and how he would treat others. They worried about whether people would run from him or be drawn to him. Would he be loved or would he be rejected? Who would he grow up to be? It's comforting to know that no matter what worries we face tonight or burdens we carry, in Jesus' presence, all things are made new. On that holy night, the world changed forever because the rock of salvation, the foundation of our hope, was born. This great news invites us to worship and to experience the presence of Jesus. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for sending your Son to us. Thank you for reminding us that our everyday fears and struggles are met with your peace, grace, and love. Challenge us this Christmas season not to worry about what's to come, but rather to focus on who came, Jesus. Remind us to simply love one another. We celebrate together as Mary and Joseph did so many years ago. We are awestruck with wonder that on a holy night, a tiny baby born in a barn would bring good news of God's love to us today. Amen.
Thank you.
I'm not crying, you're crying. That was beautiful, beautiful. Thank you so, so much. Now it's Christmas, right? It's gonna be 50 degrees today or something, but it's Christmas. So receive this the Lord's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with peace and give you his favor in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Hope, we will see you back here next week for Christmas Eve, but this week, go in peace, serve the Lord.